Hello, check. All right, people, I believe we are live. Yes, welcome to Catalysis by Vedantu. Sorry, there was some weird thing going on with the camera. Anyway, if I'm audible and visible, please write here in the chat box. You know the drill. Yes. So, dosto, let me just quickly check the focus of the camera. And for those of you who are new to the channel, welcome to Catalysis. Let me tell you that our classes always start 2 to 2.5 minutes after the stipulated time. Why? Because I want you guys to chat in the chat box and get acquainted with each other. Okay? So, Akarsh, welcome. Yeah, badhiya. Aur batao dosto. So, today the topic of the class is Catalysis and the name of the channel is also Catalysis. So, yeah. I'm pretty sure that you guys know what Catalysis is, isn't it? What is Catalysis? You've read about these ideas in your earlier classes as well. So today's class is also going to be just fun information dissipation. We'll chat with each other quite a lot in today's class. Okay. So what is a catalyst? A catalyst is something that speeds up a reaction, basically, isn't it? Catalyst is something that is used so that if a reaction is happening in 2 hours, you can do it in 2 minutes. So, catalyst basically provides an alternative pathway for the reaction to happen. Alright? It's like this. You want to go to the supermarket. What you can do is you can walk to the supermarket. But your car is the catalyst. Okay? The car will allow you to go to the supermarket and come back in a short span of time. So, just a very, very layman kind of an example it was that a catalyst technically just provides you an alternative pathway for the reaction to occur. All right, theek hai, toh badhiya hai. It just speeds up a reaction, it provides an alternative pathway. Right, so let us try to think about the energetics of this particular process. Okay, before I give you some examples, let me try to give you the diagram which I think you've already seen in organic chemistry, but I'll still try to explain it to you. So what happens in general is, alright, what happens in general is that this is a graph which I'm going to show you. This is potential energy on the y-axis. Okay, and if you don't know this graph, please make sure you note it down. So you've got potential energy on the y-axis and you've got something called the reaction coordinate. Okay, you've got something called the reaction coordinate on the x-axis. Fine? Samajh gaya? Potential energy, reaction coordinate. Now, when a reaction happens, what will be the case? When a reaction happens, you have, let's say, your reactants over here. This is your reactant over here and it is at this particular potential energy. As you know, every reaction needs some activation energy. We've studied that in chemical kinetics. Yeah, we've studied that in the Arrhenius theory. So you need to provide it some energy so that you can take it to this particular stage. What is this stage? This particular stage is basically the transition state. Isn't it? That particular stage is the transition state where things are now moving, where finally you are able to change things. Okay, so transition state is of a very high energy, and then further the reaction can happen coming to the products. This is the product. All right, now the thing is that over here we are talking about an exothermic reaction. The reaction could be endothermic as well, but whatever the reaction may be, you initially have to provide a lot of energy to reach the transition state. But what a catalyst does is, in the presence of the catalyst, this graph changes. Okay, right now what's happening? You're providing it a lot of energy and then it releases a bunch of energy to become the product. So providing this much amount of energy is very difficult for us in the laboratory. This might demand, you know, somewhere around 600, 700, 800 degrees Celsius of temperature as well. So we want to do it in an easier manner. A catalyst allows you to do that, and what a catalyst does is it takes the reaction through an alternate pathway. Reactant will be the same, product will be the same, the energy required for the transition state will be much lesser. Okay, so this is what happens in the presence of a catalyst. in presence of a catalyst. So it's basically providing you an alternative pathway. Please make sure you make that diagram. All right. And now, looking just at the diagram, can you think of what the catalyst is doing? Yeah. Can you think of what the catalyst is doing? Is the catalyst changing the reactant? Is it changing the product? Is it changing the transition state? Can you think about it? Thoda sa idea laga sakte ho ki how is the catalyst actually working? Can you think how it works? Basically, if you have a little bit of logic forming in your mind, you would realize that the catalyst targets the transition state. Yeah, targets the transition state. One more way in which reactions can happen, okay, if you don't have a transition state, then you generally have a reactive intermediate. Right? Or reactive intermediate kuch aisa banega. You basically have something like this, and then you have a reactive intermediate over here, and then it goes to the product. So over here you have an intermediate, yeah, like a carbocation or a carbon ion. Do you remember those days in organic chemistry when I used to do SN2 reaction for you, single step process, or SN1 reaction for you? First you form carbocation, then the carbocation captures whatever it wants to. You know, then the carbocation captures the nucleophile. Fine. So the intermediate can take place, right? So the catalysis in this case can happen like this. It can change the characteristics of the intermediate. The catalyst can also turn it into a single step reaction. That is also possible. Okay. So what the catalyst does is it basically messes up with the transition state or the intermediate. Okay. The catalyst basically messes up with the transition state or the intermediate. Okay. Let me remind you of one of the examples of a catalyst. Okay. Do you guys remember base catalyzed esterification? Ye yaad hai? There's acid catalyzed esterification as well, but base catalyzed is a little simple to write down. So if you remember those organic chemistry classes, you've got one acid and you've got another alcohol. What you want to do is you want this lone pair to go and attack this carbon, and then the reaction happens. Yeah, oxygen will capture electrons, oxygen will push electrons over here, and then this particular OH will leave. This is basically what happens in catalyst, basically what happens in esterification. Yeah, acid plus alcohol gives you the ester, right? This is what you want. But do you realize that this is a neutral species right now, and over here there is no urgency for this to react? This is a pretty stable neutral species. So how do you create the urgency for it to react? What you do in base catalyzed situations is you are able to create this guy. Yeah, of course this will also turn into a negative charge, that's fine, but you are able to convert the alcohol into its ion. Yeah, now instead of ROH you have RO negative, so this negative charge can come and easily attack because it's now a more reactive species. So what the catalyst is doing over here is basically it is turning this into O negative. Yeah, you've put OH negative, it captures the proton that it already had to turn it into an O negative. So the catalyst basically plays around to modify what your transition state will look like. Okay, the catalyst just modifies some things here and there, and eventually it will be giving back this H positive to your final product. Okay. So that's the interesting thing about a catalyst. It participates in the reaction, but it does not get consumed. It gets regenerated back again. That's the fun thing about a catalyst, that it is not causing you any wastage. Yeah. It is not costing you anything else. You just take 1 kilogram of catalyst, you can run an entire industry using just that 1 kilogram of catalyst, because that catalyst will keep on getting regenerated in the reaction. That 1 kg will remain 1 kg for the rest of the life of the industry. Yeah. So that's the good thing about a catalyst, that it gets regenerated again. So, just a formal definition for all of you. There's a process, KClO3 breaking apart into KCl plus 3 times O2, a decomposition reaction of KClO3. So, the thing is that generally this reaction happens at a very high temperature. It takes 4 hours, okay, happens at a very high temperature. So, in order to do this reaction easily, okay, in order to do this reaction easily, all you need to do is just put some MnO2. The reaction happens at almost, you know, half the temperature. This happens somewhere around 800 Kelvin. This can happen somewhere around 400 Kelvin as well. And the time period is also reduced drastically. Instead of 4 hours, now it's taking only 15 minutes. But this saves you a lot of time and energy and money. So, a catalyst is a substance when added to a reacting system increases the rate of the reaction without itself being consumed, and the phenomena of increasing the rate of the reaction with the help of a catalyst is known as catalysis. And hence the name of the channel. This channel does not interfere in your preparation. You have to do your own preparation. This channel just helps you get better at it without getting consumed. Rohit bro, weekends, I have a life which I live on weekends. Friday class liya tha dost maine. Okay. Achha. Siddharth is saying, do inhibitors increase the activation energy, which is a reverse of action? Nahi, not really. I mean, Yeah, Siddharth, you can think about it like that. Yeah, they basically stop the reaction from happening. So, of course, they increase the activation energy. That's a perfect corollary that you've drawn. Yeah. Utkarsh, yes, there are playlists. Cool. Tarun, yes, I will take sprint classes pretty soon. Yeah, just another 10-15 days and we'll start those sprint type classes. Okay. Cool. Yeah, I think I've answered your questions for the sprint. So, yeh ho gaya aapka catalysis, and it's a very easy topic to study. Fatafat just padh lete hain isko, then we'll chat. Okay. So, types of catalysts, depending on the phase and the catalyst reaction mixture, you can have homogeneous catalysts or you could have heterogeneous catalysts as well. Okay, homogeneous and heterogeneous. Now the thing is, a catalyst which is in the same phase as the reaction is called homogeneous catalyst. For example, the case that I showed you, acid and alcohol in the presence of base, all of them are in aqueous phase. Yeah, so that is one way. The other way, which is more interesting for us from the perspective of surface chemistry, is heterogeneous catalysis. A catalyst which does not exist in the same phase as the reactants is called a heterogeneous catalysis. Can you guys think of an example? Let me remind you of a reaction. What is the catalyst used over here? Hydrogenation of hydrocarbons. Yeah, hydrogenation of alkenes. This is a gas, this is a gas. What is the catalyst used over here? You use things like nickel, palladium, or platinum, isn't it? What are these catalysts? These are solid catalysts, isn't it? So, you are basically doing a gaseous reaction on top of solid catalysts. This scenario would become heterogeneous catalysis. Yeah? Cool. So people are saying formation of ammonia. Yes, that also uses the heterogeneous catalysis. Iron use hota us process mein. Yeah. So these are some examples of homogeneous catalysis. H2O2 with aqueous iodine will break apart into H2O plus half O2. Redox reaction basically. Yeah. And SO2 plus O2 to give SO3. You can use NO or NO2 as the catalyst. And O2 turning into O3, NO can be used as the catalyst. Okay. So all of these are, you know, aqueous solution, gaseous phase, all of these are examples of homogeneous catalysis. In case you want to write them down, just pause the video over here. I'll just give you 5 to 10 seconds. Vipin bro, catalysts that are used in the industry are industrial catalysts. Which industry? Okay, so some heterogeneous catalysts over here. As you guys have already pointed out, the Fritz-Haber's process N2 and H2 are gaseous, whereas iron is the solid.
Yeah.
So creation of ammonia for its Haber's process happens in the presence of iron. Heterogeneous catalysis. Then you've got SO2 plus O2 to give SO3. This is a different way to catalyze this reaction. Earlier, we were catalyzing this reaction using the nitrogen's oxide. That was gaseous. Over here, we are using vanadium's oxide, which is solid in nature. Yeah. So these cases are heterogeneous catalysts, and there are a bunch of examples given in the NCRT. Before you guys get bored of this class, let me tell you. Okay, before you guys get bored of the class, let me tell you this one thing. Please do this after today's class. Read and write all examples of catalysis given in the NCRT book. Direct questions can come from them. Okay, direct questions can come from these examples that are given in the NCRT. Bilkul seedha seedha question aata hai ek uthke. Okay, I'll show you where they are. Here you go. I've opened the NCRT book for you guys over here. Yeah, KClO3 example is also given in the NCRT. Okay, this example is given in the NCRT of the Fritz-Haber's process. Then this SO2 example which I showed you is given. You can see over here, this is opposite of esterification, opening of esters by acidic conditions, hydrolysis of sugar, yeah. SO2 going to SO3 in the presence of platinum. Sare ke sare examples, okay? All of these examples are very important. This one always comes. I mean, there are a lot of times when they ask about Ostwald's process. What is the catalyst used in Ostwald's process? You have to choose platinum over there. Okay, very commonly these questions are asked directly. So ye jo bhi examples dikhe aapko, whatever examples you see, yeah, this one, selectivity ke jitne bhi example diye, whatever example you see in the NCRT, please read it and write it in your notes so that you can revise them again. Pakke se kar lena please. Okay, cool. Chalo ji. So now that was the idea of a catalyst, and I've already told you of a brief image, you know, thoda sa idea maine de diya aapko, just given you an idea of how the catalysts actually work. But now let us come to the idea of how it is applicable for surface chemistry. And let this go away. There are essentially two different theories by which heterogeneous catalysts work. Okay, one theory is something that we already discussed, and that is the intermediate theory. Alright, this is one theory that we've already given some thought on. In the beginning of the class, we told that, okay, H positive, OH negative, esterification, etc. So you know an idea of what the intermediate theory is. The other theory, which is called the old theory, is known as the adsorption theory. Alright, this is the old theory, which is known as the adsorption theory. The old theory said, okay, listen to me very carefully. The old theory said that, let's say this is the solid surface of the catalyst, and what we are doing over here is the reaction of hydrogenation of alkenes. So what generally happens over here is that, let's say this is the surface of nickel, hydrogen gas will get adsorbed on this surface. Okay, now that hydrogen gas is adsorbed on the surface, there is a lot of concentration of hydrogen on the surface of nickel. Because of adsorption, there is a high concentration surface that gets created, and whenever an alkene approaches it, this reaction happens. Okay, it's easy for the alkene to approach it because there is high concentration of hydrogens on the surface. So adsorption theory, old theory, says that just because of increase in concentration on the surface, reaction is faster. Understood? Sirf aur sirf ye kehta hai wo purana theory ki yaar zyada hydrogen hoge to reaction jaldi ho jayega. It just says there are more things on the surface now, so more reaction will happen. So the modern theory of catalysts, the modern theory of catalysts combines both of these ideas. It says that it's not just intermediates that get formed, it's not just adsorption that happens. Both of the things happen at the same time. Basically, you can call it the chemisorption theory. Alright, you can call it the chemisorption theory of catalysts. Alright, and I'll give you a visual representation of what it is like. ठीक है, तो चलो अब इसका विजुअल रिप्रेजेंटेशन करते हैं. लेट अस से देयर इज अ कैटलिस्ट व्हिच हैज अ लॉट ऑफ साइट्स ऑन इट वेयर एड्सॉर्प्शन कैन हैपन. ओके, रिमेंबर द वे वी डिड लैंगमुयर्स एड्सॉर्प्शन आइसोथर्म्स. वी सेड दैट देयर आर अ लॉट ऑफ साइट्स वेयर द एड्सॉर्प्शन कैन हैपन. सो दिस इज द सर्फेस ऑफ अ कैटलिस्ट एंड दीज tiny, tiny, tiny circles that I've made are the places where my reactants can come and sit. So the reaction that I want to do is A plus B going towards AB. All right. What the chemisorption theory says is that when A comes close to this guy, okay, chemisorption happens and A sits here. When B comes close to the catalyst, chemisorption happens and B sits here. Okay, so A is sitting in one of the holes, B is sitting in one of the holes, and in both cases chemisorption has happened. Okay, so I'll make another representation over here which looks like this: A and B. Now A and B realize that they are close to each other. Another thing is, because of chemisorption, it will be an exothermic process. Yeah. Because chemisorption has happened, you provide a little bit of energy, chemisorption happened. Now the chemisorption is an exothermic process, it will release more energy. As A and B get more energy, they start reacting with each other. They start getting bound to each other. And once they start getting bound to each other, they form a bond. Alright. This process is also exothermic because bond formation is happening. Yeah. And that energy release facilitates the breaking of the chemisorption over here. And finally, your product A and B gets formed. Do you understand the step-by-step procedure? Chemisorption happened, these two guys reacted, they left. This is how catalyst works. Okay. Simple si baat hai. So, the mechanism of heterogeneous catalysis is this: chemisorption, reaction between them, they leave. Ye kya hota? This is called desorption. As simple as that. Someone is saying, who proposed the adsorption theory? I think it was Berzelius, long time back in the 1800s. That's the guy who coined the term catalysts. Now, I'm not sure who gave the theory of catalysis for the very first time. Theek hai ji? So, this is your idea behind how a catalyst works. Theek hai ji? Samajh aa gaya hoga. I don't think there's any confusion in it. So, before I go into enzymes, there are a few things that I want to tell you. Okay. First thing that I want to tell you is, what is a promoter? Promoter is something that increases the activity of a catalyst. Okay. There are some things that increase the activity of a catalyst as well. Catalyst to theek hai, but uski activity ko bhi kaise increase kiya jaye? Put something. Okay, so promoter increases the activity of a catalyst, and one very simple example, very common example which you should remember is in the Fritz-Ebers process, when you have N2 plus H2 going towards NH3 in the presence of iron, yeah, you put a little bit of molybdenum as well. This molybdenum activates the iron catalyst even more and the reaction happens even faster. Okay. So promoters increase the activity of a catalyst. This is an example that you can write down. Now the other thing, the opposite of a promoter, is a poison. Okay. The opposite of a promoter is a poison. What do poisons do? Poisons basically decrease the activity. Yeah, poison decreases the activity of the catalyst. Can you guys give me an example of this? Throwback time to organic chemistry. Can you give me an example of a catalyst where we use a poison? Siddharth, yeah. Promoter is a catalyst for the catalyst. Arvind, I'm glad you enjoyed that. Rosenmund's catalyst. Yes, BSO4 is put. Bilkul sahi. Siddharth is saying Jair. वो भी सही है. रोजनमंड्स कैटलिस्ट बिल्कुल सही. देयर इज अनदर कैटलिस्ट. रोजनमंड बिल्कुल सही है. दैट्स फाइन. आशय सिंह, बट द प्रोमोटर इज नॉट अ कैटलिस्ट इटसेल्फ. नो नो नो, इट्स नॉट, इट्स नॉट. दैट्स व्हाई वी कॉल इट अ प्रोमोटर. इज जस्ट एनेबलिंग द कैटलिस्ट टू एक्ट अ लिटिल बेटर. गणेश, वेरी नाइस. क्विनोलीन, गुड. Quinoline कहाँ होता है? Do you guys remember where we have the quinoline? And if you guys are paying attention to this class, then when I showed you the NCRT, there was one tab opened on the top in my Chrome window. Do you remember that tab? याद है? What's the name of that catalyst? याद आया? लिंडलर्स कैटलिस्ट. ओके, सो दिस इज द पॉइजन टू द कैटलिस्ट. ओके, इट इज बेसिकली स्लोइंग डाउन द एक्शन ऑफ द कैटलिस्ट. सी, विदाउट द कैटलिस्ट द रिएक्शन वॉन्ट हैपन. बट यू डोंट वॉन्ट द रिएक्शन टू हैपन टू अ वेरी हाई एक्सटेंट. यू वॉन्ट द रिएक्शन टू हैपन टू अ स्मॉलर एक्सटेंट. सो लिंडलर्स कैटलिस्ट इज वन सच एग्जाम्पल. Do you guys remember Lindlar's catalyst? It is basically palladium. Okay, it is basically palladium. But then you do so many things to palladium that it gets poisoned. What happens when you take palladium with hydrocarbons? They will get saturated. Yeah, you take alkene and hydrogen with palladium, it will turn into an alkane. But let's say you want to convert an alkyne into an alkene, but not into an alkane. Then you take palladium to do the hydrogenation reaction, but you poison it so that it doesn't do the reaction too much. Okay, so you poison it with things like quinoline or lead oxide. Let me show you the Wikipedia page of the Lindlar's catalyst, which I have opened up for you guys. ये देखो, मैं अपनी शक्ल साइड पे करता हूँ थोड़ी. Just put myself over here. Yeah, this is what is Lindlar's catalyst. Can you see? A Lindlar's catalyst is a heterogeneous catalyst that consists of palladium. This is what palladium looks like. Very nice. Deposited on calcium carbonate. Okay. Or barium sulfate. BSO4, Lindlar's catalyst. You know. So palladium on BSO4 or palladium on calcium carbonate, which is then poisoned with various forms of lead or sulfur. Sometimes poisoned with quinoline as well, which is what we read, which is what we study. It is used for the hydrogenation of alkynes to alkenes. Okay. Alkynes get converted to alkenes no more. Yeah, the reaction doesn't go any further. Just alkenes, not alkanes. Okay, so without further reduction into alkanes, and is named after the inventor Herbert Lindlar. Cool. So as you can see, you've got a triple bond and some double bonds. Only the triple bond is reduced to a double bond. As you can see, Lindlar's catalyst, hydrogen will approach this triple bond to convert it into a double bond. That is all. Okay, and do you realize, okay, one more thing that you should realize is that this catalyst, okay, the Lindlar's catalyst, which I showed you quite extensively on the Wikipedia page, this catalyst is doing the reaction in a very specific manner. The catalyst affects how the reaction happens. Okay, the catalyst governs how the reaction might happen. Lindlar's catalyst is a stereospecific catalyst. Why? Okay. It chooses one particular configuration of the reaction to happen. Let me give you the idea behind it. Okay, this is the surface of your solid catalyst, let's say nickel, palladium, platinum, whatever. And as I told you, hydrogens will get associated with this catalyst. Yeah, assume that these hydrogens have done the chemisorption with the surface. Now, when an alkene approaches, it can approach from the top side. Yeah, यहाँ पे alkene approach कर देगा, or let's say an alkyne approaches from the top side. My dear friends, do you realize that both the hydrogens in these alkenes or alkynes will approach from the same side? Yeah, I'll take a green pen to show you that. Do you see the approach of all the hydrogens will happen from the same side? This reaction that will happen will be a syn addition reaction. This reaction will be a syn addition reaction. Syn means both the hydrogens are adding up from the same side, not from the opposite sides. This is what anti addition would look like. Okay, this is what anti addition would look like. For anti-addition, you can think of the process of halohydrin formation. Yeah, remember the process of halohydrin formation. Or for anti-addition, you can think of Br2 adding to a double bond. Yeah, remember? Plus Br2 in the presence of CCl4. This is an anti-addition reaction. Again, organic chemistry things. Fine. So this is a syn-addition reaction. Stereospecific. So in case you have Lindlar's catalyst, yeah, the example that was exactly there given on the Wikipedia. Let's say you have a triple bond. You have a very simple ethyne and you react it with H2. Ethyne is not a very good example actually. Let me give you butane. Okay? And I take it in the presence of Lindlar's catalyst. What's going to happen? The hydrogen is going to add only from one side, not from both sides. Okay? Hydrogen is going to add only from one side, either like this or like this. It's not going to add up like this. Wo nahi hoga. So, the product that will get formed obviously will be a cis product. This is the butane part. Okay? And this is the new hydrogen that you've put. Both the hydrogens are approached from the same side. This is the product that you will get. You will get a cis alkene at the end. The trans alkene will not be formed. Yeah, the trans alkene will not be formed. Ye to banega hi nahi na bhai sahab. Because hydrogens are not approaching from two different directions. Only the cis product gets formed. Selecting. Okay? Selecting a specific. Okay, specifically making the cis product, not the trans product. Very specific, right? Specificity means to choose one thing over the other entirely. Very specific. So this reaction is stereospecific in nature. It specifies that it will get cis, not trans at all. If both were formed, let's say there's a reaction where both are formed, trans is 10%, cis is 90%, then the reaction would be stereoselective. It selects one over the other, but does the other as well. Okay, stereoselective is when it's not 100%. When there's only one type of product, 100%, this is stereospecific. Got it? So this revises the idea of stereospecificity versus stereoselectivity for you, I guess. Theek hai ji? To ye hoti hai baat. Cis being 100%, Lindlar's catalyst is a very specific catalyst. So the kind of catalyst you use alters the mechanism of the reaction, and that can change the specificity of the reaction as well. In formation of diols from alkenes, you have multiple reagents, and those different reagents give you different reaction mechanisms. So that's the idea that you need to remember. The catalysts can change the way a reaction happens. Chalo, aage badhte hain. Now let's come to enzymes. And what's up with enzymes? Enzymes are biochemical catalysts. They're present over here. Yeah. स्क्रीन थोड़ी छोटी है ये, सो ओनली दिस मच पार्ट ऑफ मी कम्स इनसाइड द स्क्रीन. दिस इज जस्ट अ 65 इंच स्क्रीन. द स्क्रीन्स दैट वी यूज एट द ऑफिस वर क्वाइट बिगर देन दिस. सो इन द स्क्रीन्स इन द ऑफिस यू कैड एक्चुअली सी द एंटायरिटी ऑफ मी. बट ये हम स्क्रीन छोटी क्या करें. सो इन द टमी वी हैव गॉट एंजाइम्स. Yeah, and there are several reactions that occur in the human body which are called biochemical reactions. All biological reactions are catalyzed by enzymes. Enzymes are biological catalysts. Fine. So, same thing, very similar to your heterogeneous catalysis, that same thing happens in the body. So, since it is happening in the body, we call it a biochemical catalyst. Okay. So, enzymes are complex nitrogenous organic compounds which are produced by living plants and animals. This information is very important for NEET students, by the way. And if you are a NEET student, you know this better than I do, I guess. Okay. So, what are enzymes? Enzymes are actually protein molecules. What are protein molecules? Protein molecules are basically biomolecules that have a component of nitrogen in them. Yeah. Nitrogenous biomolecules are generally proteins. So they are actually protein molecules of high molecular mass and they form colloidal solutions in water. Okay, theek hai. Now these enzymes are termed as biochemical catalysts and the phenomena is, useless statement. And they are very effective catalysts and they catalyze numerous reactions, especially those connected with natural processes. Pretty simple basic statements that I've given you. The main thing on this entire page is that they're actually protein molecules of high molecular mass, nitrogenous compounds. Chalo. So, the interesting thing about the enzyme is, and these questions are generally directly asked in NEET, okay, that what is the efficiency of the enzyme? By how many times does the enzyme increase the rate of the reaction? They'll ask you 10 to 20 times, 100 to 1000 times. 10 to the power 8 to 10 to the power 20 times, none of the above. So you have to choose this option. Okay. They are very efficient catalysts. Can you see how much they are increasing the rate of the reaction? Can you just see that? Read this statement. This will tell you. In our body, the digestive system takes maximum, 1 day? Maximum 2 days to digest whatever you put inside. Maximum, okay. Efficiently happens in half a day as well. If there were no enzymes in our digestive system, it would have taken 50 years to digest a single meal. 50 years to do what your body is capable of doing in just one day. This is how effective these enzymes are. And when people get old, their enzyme production gets affected, bodily functions keep shutting down or slowing down. So that is why when people grow up, when people get older, it becomes difficult for them to digest food. Enzyme nahi banta body mein. So there are a lot of pharmaceutical companies that manufacture synthetic enzymes. So a lot of people, when they eat really heavy food, they take one spoon of those digestive enzymes as well. So as you can see, each enzyme catalyzes only one chemical reaction. For example, enzyme ureas catalyze only hydrolysis of urea and not of N-methylurea, which is similar to it. So these are very specific. Okay, enzymes are very specific. Aisa nahi ki aapne aaj plastic kha liya toh, even if you eat this plastic pen, it will not be digested in your body because the enzymes in your body are specific. They will recognize that, okay, you are putting fat molecules in the body. Let's attack these fat molecules and eat them. Have you guys heard of trans fats? Have you guys heard of trans fatty acids? The fun thing about trans fats is that even if you put these trans fats in a very small amount, okay, so if you read the label of your butter or ghee or milk or a lot of these substances, fat substances, they will read trans fat content, this. The thing is that these trans fats are actually artificial. And the US is planning to ban these trans fats in 2021 or something. As far as I know, my information might be wrong. These trans fats are सिंथेटिक फैट्स. ओके, जनरली द फैट्स दैट वी हैव इन आर बॉडी आर सिस इन नेचर. ओके, बड़ी सारी चेन होगी कुछ तो फैट की, एंड देन देयर इज गोना बी अ डबल बॉन्ड समवेयर एंड इट्स अ सिस. इट्स एन अनसैचुरेटेड फैटी एसिड, अनसैचुरेटेड फैट मॉलिक्यूल. व्हाट आर फैट मॉलिक्यूल्स? वेरी लॉन्ग कार्बोक्सिलिक एसिड्स. ओके, सो वॉट एवर फैट वी ईट आर वेरी लॉन्ग कार्बोक्सिलिक एसिड. सम ऑफ देम हैव डबल बॉन्ड्स इन देम. ओके, सम ऑफ देम हैव ट्रिपल बॉन्ड्स इन देम. देन वी कॉल देम अनसैचुरेटेड फैटी एसिड्स. Now these unsaturated fatty acids naturally are found to be in the cis configuration, but sometimes they can be in the trans configuration, and this is synthetic. What happens is that even if you put a 0.1% of trans fat into any oil or ghee or butter, it will increase its shelf life by years. It's going to increase the shelf life by years. If your oil without a fatty acid, unrefined oil, if it will stay outside for, let's say, 1 week, you know, that rancid smell starts coming out from oil when it gets oxidized. Old oil ki smell pata hai ye tumhe. That old oil will increase its life by years if you put a little bit of trans fat in it. Okay? Trans fats are something that are not digestible by human body. They are not digestible by animal bodies. So if your food contains trans fat, even insects will not attack it very fast. Even microorganisms will not attack it very fast. But humans are not smart enough to understand that, so we keep on eating things with trans fats as well. So again, our body can catalyze these cis fats, but trans fats cannot be catalyzed. So these start clogging up the arteries, and trans fats are a very very huge reason for a lot of cardiac problems eventually in life. So that's why slowly and steadily the governments are trying to ban it. There is a lot of awareness. You will see there are a lot of companies which sell organic products. They will say zero trans fats on their products. Yeah, so people are getting a little more aware about it. So that's the point of enzyme specificity. It's so specific that even if one configuration around a double bond is different, it will not digest the fat. Enzymes are so specific. Only a small quantity is needed because they are regenerated, as I already told you. And the optimum temperature and pH is body temperature. Yeah. Body temperature around 37 degrees Celsius and pH 7.4. If you have a temperature, then your bodily functions will not function properly. You know? If you have high temperature. So enzymes catalyze reactions have maximum rate at physiological temperature and pH of the body. Ronak, yes, I am live right now. Cool. These are what enzymes are. What is the mechanism of enzyme catalysts? Very similar to your heterogeneous catalyst example that I gave. Yeah, chemisorption happens, then the product gets formed, then desorption happens. Very similar. Over here, enzyme and substrate, they call it a lock and key mechanism. Because enzymes are very specific, the theory behind it is that enzymes have a specific shape. In that shape, only that particular material can fit. Yeah. Let's say your enzyme has this type of a shape. Okay, enzyme has this type of a shape. So over here, do you realize only a cis acid can get fit? If you put a trans acid over here, it will not fit. Isn't it? Yahan pe agar maine trans acid dal diya, fit kaise hoga? Can't fit. So we generally call it a key lock mechanism. Okay, key fitting the lock mechanism. So enzyme and substrate, very specific shapes. Enzyme and substrate completely fit with each other. Then whatever you have to break down will break down into products. And remember, enzymes always break things down. Yeah, you put complex fat molecules in your body, it breaks down. You put complex protein molecules in your body, it breaks down. So on and so forth. Yeah. So enzymes catalyze the breakdown of a lot of natural substances. So these are active centers on the surface of enzyme particles. These cavities are of characteristic shape and possess active groups such as NH2 or COOH or SH or OH, which can facilitate the movement of electrons, because a chemical reaction at the end is a movement of electrons. Yeah. So as I told you, it's like a key fitting a lock. Seema, NCRT and N Awasthi. ठीक है जी. सो दिस इज वॉट एन एंजाइम डज एंड दीज आर सम एग्जाम्पल्स मैंशनड इन द एनसीईआरटी एंड टूडेज क्लास इज बेसिकली वर डन विद टूडेज क्लास. इट वॉज जस्ट एन इन्फॉर्मेशन डिसिपेशन सेशन बिकॉज दिस सर्फेस केमिस्ट्री चैप्टर इज वेरी इजी. आई थिंक इन द नेक्स्ट टू टू थ्री डेज वी विल बी एबल टू कवर ऑल द सेक्शन ऑफ कोलॉइड्स एज वेल. सो टुमोरोज क्लास आई मीन द नेक्स्ट टू थ्री क्लासेज विल बी रिलेटेड टू कोलॉइड्स. So what are colloids, what are gels, what are this, what are that, how do we compare colloids to solutions, what is, the property of colloids, etc. So that's the discussion for the next few days, very important discussion. So this particular information is again given in the NCERT. So since it is given in the NCERT, it would be good if you can remember these, because in NEET examinations and sometimes in J, this will come directly, okay? They'll ask you, which catalyst catalyzes maltase into glucose? Char naam diye honge, you have to click. Which catalyst converts maltose into glucose? And you have to click on the maltase option. Simple se aise question aa jaate hain. Alright, so the thing is that today's class is over. The homework for you is a humble request from my side, please. अरे यार प्लीज रीड द एनसीईआरटी. ओके इट्स पीडीएफ इज अवेलेबल ऑनलाइन फॉर फ्री. आई विल वंस अगेन शो यू द पार्ट दैट यू हैव टू रीड फॉर कैटालिसिस. वेरी सिंपल वेरी क्रिस्प पार्ट दैट्स रिटन इन द एनसीईआरटी. ठीक है तो ये दिया है सारा. ओके स्टार्ट्स फ्रॉम हियर कैटालिसिस. What is the page number? 127. Okay, in surface chemistry chapter, page number 127 से start हो रहा है. All right, you read it. Promoters and poisons, we've talked about it. Homogeneous catalysis, heterogeneous catalysis, we've talked about that. Given some examples, adsorption theory of heterogeneous catalysts, old theory, new theory, we've talked about that as well. Yeah, and I have given you this example as well. सब कुछ कर लिया. Shape selective catalysts by zeolites. This is your self study. You have to read this. It's just one paragraph. ये बस छोटा सा paragraph है. Okay, and then we've talked about enzymes as well, but there are a bunch of examples given over here. Okay, sugar getting converted to glucose, invertase, yeah, glucose into ethyl alcohol, zymase, starch into malcol, maltose, diastase, okay, urea into ammonia and carbon dioxide, urease. So you have to remember these examples. Okay, you have to remember these examples. Please make sure you study the NCERT part. Okay. Since I have explained things for you in today's class, these ideas mentioned in the NCERT will be very simple. So please make sure you read it. And next class is tomorrow at 8:30 as usual. For all of you who are worried about the sprint classes, don't worry. We will begin those by the mid of this month, most likely by December 15th or 20th on this channel. ठीक है फॉर केमिस्ट्री. बढ़िया चलो. सो वी आर डन विद टुडेज क्लास. आई विल जस्ट चैट विद यू गाइस फॉर 2-3 मिनट्स. अगेन एज यू नो दैट वी रन अ लॉट ऑफ कोर्सेज एट वेदांतु. इफ यू वांट टू जॉइन अ क्रैश कोर्स देन यू कैन गो डाउन टू द डिस्क्रिप्शन बॉक्स एंड ओपन द लिंक्स फॉर जे 2021 क्रैश कोर्स. आई थिंक देयर इज अ डिस्काउंट रनिंग ऑन दैट एज वेल. कूपन कोड इज गिवन इन द डिस्क्रिप्शन बॉक्स. कूल बढ़िया चलो. So that is saying I am not able to study organic. Whenever I study organic, I am not able to identify reactions. So that first of all, you are limiting yourself by telling yourself that you can't do it. Stop. It will take time. Some people understand it fast. Some people understand it slow. Second is practice more and more questions. The more questions you practice, the more you see the same things again and again, the better your mind will become at recognizing the patterns of organic chemistry. Okay, and I'm pretty sure my classes will help you as you are a regular student of mine. So I'm pretty sure you've already seen the classes. Okay, so don't limit yourself by telling that you can't do it. Try to watch some question solving classes that we've done on this channel. Art of Deduction series is something that can help you. Try to see those for organic reactions and try to do those yourself from MS Chauhan. Even if it takes 1 hour to do one question, do it. Recognizing the pattern will become a habit for your brain only after you've done it n number of times. Tatrada, thank you so much for your compliments, people. When will biomolecules start? Gary, we've already done a very good class on biomolecules, which is, it's more than enough. So all you need to do is just open the playlist section of our channel. Okay, go to this playlist called Let's Revit. When you open the playlist, this is what will get opened. Okay, over here, just open the class of biomolecules. This 1 hour class of biomolecules, I've taught it from top to bottom. Okay, so this is as good as a full class of biomolecules. It's already there on the channel. Just watch this. You'll be good to go. And if you want to solve questions of biomolecules after this, just open the playlist called The Art of Deduction. And yahan pe bhi, you will get the class on biomolecules. Yahin kahin pe hai. Yeah, so biomolecules, question solving is also there. So, I don't want to do the same thing twice. You can just go and watch it over there. Okay, Mohammed Sahil, let me clarify this. Arvind Roda sir is a very good friend of mine. ठीक है जी, तो उनका अपना चैनल है, हमारा अपना चैनल है, अब मन चला रहे अपना अपना चैनल. Okay, Mohammed Sahil, thank you so much for trying to spread hate over here. I'm blocking you from this channel. Thank you so much for watching. Okay. Satvik, I just told you 2 minutes back. Akshat, solve questions, please. Start solving previous year questions for every topic. That will start giving you confidence every time you revise them. Dhruv, that session that I told you is an elaborate session already. Please watch that. Asha, inhibitors can be thought of as negative catalysts. Poisons are things that stop the activity of the catalyst itself. Okay. Divyansh, for one subject I used to have, for 11th class I had like 3 chemistry notebooks, maybe 2. For 12th also 2 or 3. Bada wala notebook leta tha main yaar. 15, 16 ka hai bhaiya, pagla gaye ho ka? One chapter is not equal to one notebook, bro. I hardly had like 3 notebooks for chemistry in 12th class. Rahman, opposite of adsorption is desorption. Please watch the lecture 1 and lecture 2 of this chapter. Chalo, people, that's all from my side for today's class. Thank you so much for joining in. If you've got any more comments, questions and queries, leave it in the comment section down below after the live stream is done. If you enjoyed today's class, please make sure you hit that thumbs up button. I will see you tomorrow at 8:30. And until next time, take care. Bye-bye. See you soon.